It's honestly crazy to me that in just a few months, I'll be graduating from college. And I know that this journey could not have been possible without the professors that sat through my questions during office hours, my friends and family, and all of the love and support that they provided me with over the years, and of course, the internet. When there were times that I just couldn't understand a finance concept, or my roommate wasn't around to discuss the latest Euphoria episode with me, or I was cramming for an exam and I couldn't identify the song stuck in my head, I turned to the internet. And each time I found it remarkable that there was someone somewhere out there that was asking the same questions that I was. I found community thanks to the technologically driven interconnectedness of our present world. Today, more people have access to cell phones than they do to toilets and proper sanitation services. And to me, this shows two things. First, that technology has become indispensable to our day-to-day lives and is essential for everyone to have an equitable shot at opportunity. But that second, there are so many technological products out there. When we talk about sustainability and environmental preservation, technological products aren't always mentioned, though they should be. Technological product waste, also known as electronic waste, or e-waste for short, is the world's fastest growing waste stream. In 2019, we generated 53.6 million metric tons of it. Now, I know that this number alone is a little hard to comprehend, so let's put it in a few more relatable terms. 53.6 million metric tons is almost the equivalent of throwing out 1,000 laptops every single second of every minute of every day. 1,000 laptops. 1,000 laptops. 1,000 laptops. 53.6 million metric tons, or the amount of e-waste generated in just 1 year, weighs more than all of the commercial airliners ever made. And 53.6 million metric tons is enough to cover an area the size of Manhattan. Now, I want y'all to really picture this in your minds, Manhattan covered with our old phones and laptops. This doesn't feel too far removed from the world of WALL-E, now does it? Where we escape the Earth because we've littered it with our own carelessness? Okay, 53.6 million metric tons of e-waste. But what exactly does e-waste mean? E-waste is any electronic product that's reached the end of its useful life cycle. And though so far I've used phones and laptops as examples, it really encompasses every single electronic product that you own. In fact, phones and laptops only make up a sliver of total e-waste. E-waste is the electric toothbrush that you use every morning, that I hope you used before coming here today. It's all of the products that Dr. Scott Tinker mentioned in his talk. It's the lava lamp that's sitting in your garage from back in the day. And it's the LED lights in all of your teenagers' rooms, a trend that I really, really hope ends soon. But out of all of these 53.6 million metric tons of e-waste, only 20% is being recycled. And what I mean by it being recycled is that electronic parts are brought to electronic recyclers where they are then disassembled and then categorized according to what they're made out of, what function they serve, if they can be resold and reused as is, or if they need to be broken down further to get the materials that make them so valuable, like gold or silver. And there's a lot of economic opportunity in recycling our e-waste. The World Economic Forum and the United Nations estimate that the total recoverable value in our electronic waste is $62.5 billion, with a B, dollars. But we only recover 20% of the $62.5 billion every year because we only recycle 20% of our e-waste. Also, every single year, more and more consumers buy more and more electronic products because our world is becoming more technologically driven. And so, manufacturers are racing to balance supply and demand, and especially amid supply chain issues, shortages, like the chip shortage we saw a few months ago, are becoming increasingly more common. Recycling our e-waste can help alleviate some of this burden and also achieve significant cost savings. Some studies estimate that by recycling and reclaiming our e-waste, we can find cost savings of as much up to 13 times compared to traditional methods of finding materials for our electronic products. Recycling our e-waste makes environmental and economic sense. But that's just 20%, what happens to the rest of our e-waste? The other 80% of our e-waste ends up in our landfills, where e-waste is incinerated, compacted, and melted down, and toxic fumes and chemicals emit into our water, our air, and our land. This is becoming a global health issue. And it's important to note that in the United States, historically, minority populations are disproportionately more likely to be living near landfills and other hazardous waste sites, thanks to a series of historic, unjust, and discriminatory legislative, economic, and social pressures. E-waste is perpetuating this history of environmental racism, not just in the United States, but across the world. Because the story of e-waste handling is not as simple as some is recycled and most is thrown in the trash. The United Nations estimates that 40% of the United States' e-waste ends up in developing countries. This is known as waste colonialism, the practice of dumping and discarding our materials in developing countries, not because we lack the resources to handle it, but because we simply don't care. And it's incredibly unfair, because not only are we using developing countries as our own personal outsourced landfills, we're also using them as informal recycling sites. E-waste recyclers have to adhere to a number of strict health and safety regulations because the recycling process can also emit fumes into local communities. And adhering to these regulations can be quite costly. And to avoid these costs, recyclers go to developing countries. And here, men, women, and children are hired at often unreasonably low wages to unsafely sift through our decaying electronics. And our electronics abroad have an unconscionable and disastrous effect on the environment. Gyu, China receives a significant amount of e-waste. It's actually been dubbed as the e-waste capital of the world. And its waterways are so black, polluted, and acidic that it's said that its surface waters can disintegrate a penny within a matter of hours. At this point, you might be wondering, Sanika, there's no ways that there's no laws about this. And there's one called the Basel Convention, which is an international treaty signed in 1992, which aims to stop the export of hazardous waste across borders. But unfortunately, e-waste sometimes escapes the scrutiny of the Basel Convention because it gets termed as a secondhand or a reused product instead of just hazardous waste. Also, watchdogs every single year find the United States and other developed countries that claim to do good to be in direct violation of the terms of the Basel Convention. Electronic waste is also not seen as an international priority. I bet y'all hadn't heard of e-waste before you came here today either. And it's left out of international conferences time and time again. COP26 was lauded as the most important and defining climate conference of our decade, but e-waste was not included in the number of issues to be discussed then. Without formal international structures to address e-waste, and without e-waste becoming an international priority, these issues will continue to slip under the rug. But how did we get here? How did we get into this mess? How did we start generating so much electronic waste? Well, part of it begins with our own consumption. We're often told by our network providers, electronic manufacturers are peer pressured by society that we need to be buying the latest and most useful tech because it makes us cooler and better. And stopping the e-waste issue is going to need to involve all of the players I just mentioned that are perpetuating overconsumption habits. To begin, companies need to integrate circular economy practices into their manufacturing. We know that recycling our electronics makes economic sense. Why can't it make environmental sense too to companies? It leads to cost savings, and it builds greener, more sustainable, and safer technologies. But we also need to look at ourselves and accept responsibility. A lot of the times when we upgrade our devices, they're working perfectly fine. We just want to have newer ones. In preparing for today's talk, I puzzled over how I might be able to express to y'all why exactly this issue is so personal to me, when it should be personal to everybody here. And it's hard to boil it down to just one factor, but I think one of them is that I'm a daughter of immigrants. And my parents come from India, a country that will face one of the most adverse effects of electronic waste in this century. And my dad is also an engineer. And an exercise he brought me up with is that I would have to sit down and look at a technological product in our house and sit for 30 minutes and really try to understand how it worked. Later on, he'd come back and he'd quiz me. How does it work? How much of it is actual utility and how much of it is just designed for our own pleasure and benefit? And I hated the exercise then. I mean, come on, I was 9 and I wanted to play on my Wii. But he did instill in me a desire to not take things at face value, especially when it comes to technology and our usage of them. He pushed me to be curious about the world. And I carried those critical thinking skills with me to college, where I sat in my freshman year water law and ethics class and wondered why electronic waste was just breezed over when we talked about water contamination and quality, when e-waste is an issue that has an enormous effect on both. I carried those skills with me on nights out with my friends, when I embarrassingly had to ask if we could use their phone to take pictures instead of mine, because I was kicking it then, and I'm still kicking it, with a secondhand iPhone 7. Why did I feel embarrassed about utility? Why does curbing our consumption hit a nerve? After all, the blurry disposable look in photos is in right now, and I don't have to edit my photos to get that. My phone does it naturally. We all have those friends that will always upgrade their phones year after year, and that's fine, for now. But eventually, our consumption habits are going to perpetuate harms, physical, environmental, and psychological, to those around the world. But beyond societal change, we need institutional support. Without buy-in from our institutions, structural change cannot happen. What I mean by this is that in the United States, there's no federal definition or legislation as to what e-waste is. We have to push our legislators to take action on this. The good news is that we're seeing some positive movements on this front. For example, the recently introduced Right to Repair Act empowers consumers to be able to rebuild their own electronics. And although the act isn't fully passed, it's only been introduced, it's had ripple effects throughout the ecosystem. It pushed Apple to reverse a year, years-long worth of policies that prevented consumers from being able to buy their own parts and have the proper documentation that is essential for the repair process. We have to push our legislators because they will push the rest of the ecosystem in return. But we can also be donating our electronic products. COVID-19 really highlighted the deep technological divide that exists in our communities, in Texas, in the United States, and around the world. At a time when technology is so indispensable to day-to-day life, you have the opportunity to level the playing field and make sure that it's one that's safe, green, and sustainable for generations to come. Now, I know that all of this can feel very dreary and overwhelming and quite like this screenshot from WALL-E, and I hear you and I feel you. But I want you to see, hear, and believe me when I say that I have faith. I am a climate optimist. Because 3 years ago, just around this time, I was probably procrastinating a paper, and I couldn't get that oversight from my water law and ethics class out of my head. And I turned to the internet again, and I looked. What is e-waste? How can I help? How do I contribute to this issue? Where are landfills near me? And along the way, I ended up finding a community of conscious consumers that realized that even with this overwhelming, massive issue, small actions on our part can drive a change. We cannot buy electronics as often. We can push for legislation on this matter. We can donate our products. Lobbying works. We can be there for one another. Today, I've given you some of the answers to the question here on the screen, and you have a blueprint to take action. Your phone might be destroying the planet, but you have the opportunity to repurpose that technology for the next generation. So I ask you, will you take it? Thank you.